beard of a buffalo, but kind of the mane of a lion over here. Let that be there. The horns are kind of a combination of a variety of different animals that I've been studying, kind of a twisting, rolling angles that just seemed like it should be something like that. As I was drawing this, I'm thinking, is Belle gonna actually fall in love with this guy? This is, I'll soften him a little, I'll give him cow ears. That kind of makes him a little bit friendlier that way. But I knew that there is a prince. There's a man trapped inside. And as I'm drawing the eyes, the eyes being the window to the soul, I got this sense that the beast was staring right back at me at that point. I was like, that's him. There he is. That, he's going to look like that. And it was very clear that character, I recognized him. Of course, then I could only draw him from a three-quarter angle like that. As soon as I did profile, he was gone. And then I would have to keep working to find that character. For me, drawing has always been the way that I step into whatever film I'm working on, whatever creative ideas I'm working on. It's the pathway. I mean, I love characters that believe the impossible is possible. Probably the character that most defines that is Ariel. This is a character who lives under the water, but believes that she can actually walk on the land. When I'm animating, I'm drawing pretty much like that. But actually, before the tie down version, they really look like that. Now, to me, there's an energy to that drawing. I think of it as kind of a creative explosion for me. And the line is I think of line as like a seismograph of the soul for me. Somehow I connect how I feel with you. What I'd like to do is show a rough version of animation, because that's, to me, there's something really special and personal about that, at least in my drawings. And part of your world, animated Ariel singing that song, and I ended up getting kind of a crummy copy of a video of it. I mean, it's all that exists of that, but I can show it to you, and this is just the rough animation of part of your world.
Ariel, are you okay? If only I could make you understand. I just don't see things the way he does. I don't see how a world that makes such wonderful things could be bad. Look at this stuff. Isn't it neat? Wouldn't you think my collection's complete? Wouldn't you think I'm a girl? A girl who has everything. Look at this trove. Treasures untold. How many wonders can one cavern hold? Looking around here, you think, sure, she's got everything. I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty. I've got who's-its and what's-its galore. You want thingamabobs? I got 20. But who cares? No big deal. I want more. I want to be where the people are. I want to see, them dancing, walking around on those, what do you call them? Flipping your fins, you don't get too far. Legs are required for jumping, dancing, strolling along down the, what's that word again? Street. Up where they walk, up where they run, up where they stay all day in the sun, wandering free. Wish I could
still works. Even not in color. When I see that, there's, it reminds me of how I felt at a certain point when I was animating this. You know, when you are animating, when you are doing anything creative, expressive, you are opening yourself up for other people to look into your heart. And that can be a very uncomfortable thing. I find that for me, when I am being most vulnerable, that's when there's a voice in my mind that's saying, oh, don't do this. No, don't do that. Don't, no, no. But it's that's the voice that I can't listen to. And I have to actually be me up there. And actually, in part of your world where Ariel is swimming and she's swimming up, and there's this point where she reaches out as she wants to be part of that world, and she sinks back down. And I knew that she wanted to reach out and do that. I was like, oh, it's so cheesy. No, really reaching to the audience. I'm a 33-year-old guy. This is so sentimental. I can't play at all. This is, everybody's going to know. But I couldn't stop her. She did it. And years later, I was speaking at CalArts, and a student came up and said, Mr. Keane, there was this moment in part of your world where Ariel's singing, and she reaches out towards the audience. Do you remember that part? I said, yeah, I remember that part. And I was only 4 years old at the time, but I stood up in the middle of the movie theater, and I reached out to take Ariel's hand, to pull her out so she could be with me, because I knew that's what she wanted. She wanted to be part of my world. I was like, I could kiss you. It's moments like that that are the most rewarding, when you actually don't listen to that voice, you put yourself out there, and you are vulnerable. You're you. You're taking your own life, and you are sharing it with other people. That's what this is about. That's what being an artist is about. My dad is a cartoonist. He based a comic strip, Family Circus, on his own family. That's me over in the right-hand corner with the kind of dumb look. Dad's sketch of me in 1959. Dad was like a kid himself. He would paint on the walls of the house. Here he's painted little handprints on the door. That's my brother Jeff. You can't see it. For some reason, the image isn't quite there. But he's looking at his hand going, I don't remember paint on my hand. When my dad passed away, we sold the house, and I wanted to take a picture of this bar. That's my wife Linda there, but not because the bar is so special, but if you crawl under the bar, like I did, you would find that drawing. All right, wise guy, get out from under the bar. Who does that? I mean, why? Dad, he's like a kid. He would crawl into these places and draw, and thinking like a child is so vital, never losing that childlike innocence. When I was a kid, I remember I would do these big drawings in the classroom on the blackboard, the nativity scene. But I remember this particular day, because I had drawn those sheep in the foreground. They look like hamsters, but they're actually sheep. When I drew them, I was so aware that I suddenly was drawing dimension and space, because they were big and everything behind it was smaller. And so as I'm reaching into there and drawing that hay on the roof, I can feel my hand going into space, and I just don't remember that dimension. And for me, when I animate, I don't animate to do a drawing. I animate to make the paper go away, to live in that world with the character, the real. Picasso said, when I was young, I could paint and draw like Raphael, but it's taken me a lifetime to learn to draw like a child. There's a freedom that he draws with. It's very carefree. as an artist, you want your artwork to be speaking to you. It's a relationship that you're having with that. Now, my son Max, when he was little, he said, this is a sketch I did of him, but he said, "Dad, teach me to draw." So I did this page filled with these drawings, and I put expressions and attitudes under each drawing, under each circle, and he was supposed to fill in the face. And they were complicated expressions. I mean, I had no right to do that to a six-year-old, but in 15 minutes, he came back with all these drawings. And it was incredible. They were complex faces. Like, this was peaceful. Well, the only reason that he would draw peaceful with somebody whistling is that he asked himself, "How do I feel when I'm peaceful?" I mean, it's make-believe. Kids just automatically go into make-believe. "Let's play make-believe." That's what we would always say. And he knew that when he's whistling, his mouth feels like a funnel like that. So he draws it like that. Teasing. You know, I was looking at the drawing. I don't know what's coming out of the nose. I didn't ask that. I said, "But Max, what are those little squiggly lines in the eyes?" He said, well, that's when Claire, that's his sister, when Claire's teasing me, those are the lightning bolts." He was living in the skin of the characters that he drew. Michelangelo said, "Let this be plain to all. Design, or as it is called by another name, drawing, constitutes the fountainhead and substance of painting and sculpture and architecture and every other kind of painting, and is the root of all computer sciences." Now, again, I said it wrong. "Let him who has attained the possession of this be assured that he possesses a great treasure." There's something wonderful in a pencil. You know, I mean, it's about as simple of an invention as you're going to find. You don't have to boot it up. It just automatically is ready. And it somehow connects into your mind and flows right through your hand and ends in a point. And it's in that point that you express your thoughts and ideas. That's why sketches are so vital, to be able to do your little thumbnails and think about that, whether it's in a pencil or it could be working with a computer. It could be just a very expensive pencil. Top animator at Disney used to be a plumber, doesn't draw, but the computer for him is this wonderful way of expressing himself. It's that idea that there is a direct channel from how you think and feel, that you've got to have a way of communicating something inside of you to the outside. That's what Michelangelo was saying, and that's the root of all creative activity that you're going to do, is taking what's inside of you and finding a way of putting that out. I really wanted to be at Disney after I had ended up at CalArts for 2 years. And this is a photo of Disney Studios in Burbank, and dreamed about being there. And I worked on all of these drawings, what I thought were the best drawings I could do, and went in and showed them as a portfolio to Eric Larson. And Eric Larson was kind of a grandfatherly old man, you know, big belly on him. Men with big bellies have a choice where to put the belt, you know, up the belly. Truck drivers wear it down. Grandfatherly old men, they wear it up above the curb. Eric, I brought in all these drawings, and he took a look and said, "Well, let's see what you've got here." And he started going through my drawings. Well, I spent 3 months on that drawing. They were finally rendered paintings. I wanted to be a painter or a layout artist at Disney. I I just didn't believe that I could animate, but I could draw backgrounds of trees. But he was, and he stopped on this one sketch. He said, and actually the top and bottom are cut off a little bit from what I can see on my screen here, but he said, can you do more like that? I said, well, yeah, I mean, I wasn't even going to put that in there. He said, well, he said, if you can do more like this, maybe there's a place for you here. So I went out and got a set of notebooks, 100 pages in each one, and went to the beach and drew people running and playing and throwing frisbees, and I went to the zoo and came back a week later with 700 drawings and gave it to him. And I was hired with this group of trainees at the studio at that time, and it was very much like a like a school, like here. This is me with the beard and long hair. Believe it or not, it was a wonderful time of learning from one another. I've always felt like you learn a lot from your teachers, but sometimes it's from each other you learn the most. But this was also a place of the baton being passed on. Ollie Johnston was my mentor, and I'd go over to his house and we would talk about animation. And he was constantly telling me, giving me little bits of wisdom that I go back and I write it and put it on my desk. And sometimes he would say, "Oh, Glen, I'm going to tell you something that's very important, and you're not ready to understand it yet." I said, "Well, go ahead and tell me anyway." "Yes, I'm going to tell you, but you know, someday you'll understand." And I'd write these things down, and throughout my career, these things would come back, and you'd understand them on a deeper level. The principles of animation, you don't understand once, you don't understand it twice, you understand it 1,000 times over and over and over and over again in deeper ways. And that's how it's been for me in my career. I truly feel like I am one of you. I am just starting. I really don't feel like there's much of a gap other than probably 40 years. I would look at Ollie's drawings. You know, he would do a drawing of the fox, and he would explain squash and stretch, but it would be the most wonderful soft pencil he would use. His pencil would like kiss the paper, and there's calories in those lines. You know, you can fat just looking at it. You know, you could feel the texture of the fox's fur. There's something true about his drawn line, and that stuck with me forever. As I animate, even today, I remember moments of just seeing Ollie draw and the way he would touch the paper and feel the form. That's in my mind. On The Fox and the Hound, I was trying to draw this powerful bear and to get the feeling of the energy of that in these charcoal drawings. And I was so afraid that we were going to lose all that with the cleanup line, to reduce that down to one line. Well, Walt Disney had a guy working with him at the very beginning, Ub Iwerks, who started Disney with him. Well, by the time I got there, Ub's son, Don, was head of research, and Don came up and said, "Hey Glen, we've got this way of a photographic process of taking a photo of those charcoal drawings, and we'll put it onto a cell, and you can actually have your charcoal animation drawings up on the screen." It's like, whoa, this is so cool, this is going to be wonderful. But then we ran out of time, didn't get a chance to do it. And that's exactly how I felt. And you're so disappointed. And at that time, I didn't understand, though, that when you have a dream of something and you can taste it and, oh, it's gotta be, and then it goes away, it doesn't go away. It just goes underground. It's like a stream of water that looks like it dries out, but it doesn't dry out. It just goes underground to come out later on. And these ideas of finding a way of taking the expressive line and celebrating that is something that I will always hang on to. One point, John Lasseter and I, we were working at the studio, and we went across the street. Tron had just been gone into development, and across the way we saw what they were doing with the light cycles moving in and out, and we came back into my office totally impressed, because here they were using the dimension of the screen in ways that we couldn't in traditional animation. We had a big, beautiful multiplane camera there that no one could use because it was just way too expensive. We would, we were allowed one shot. We were allowed one moment in Fox and Hound for a multiplane shot. But here in Tron, every shot was a multiplane. So we thought, well, let's come up with a way of animating in dimension. And we couldn't do the character yet, so I animated the character, but we painted him as if he was dimensional. This was Marie Sendak, Where the Wild Things Are. We thought, well, this would be a fun little test. And John worked out the background, and this was the first little test that we did. In conjunction with studio up at Manchester. I just was talking with Jan over there as he was one of the guys with Chris Wedge and John Lasseter and I, and this was our first little test. What you look at now and you go, it's moving vectors, you know, in the background. But this was like amazing. The world was dimensional. I was flying through a hallway and being able to animate this dog. I had a little robot figure that I could figure out perspective on. And the future just seemed to be screaming for what was possible. And I find that anytime the computer or technology has crossed my path, I've always embraced it because it seems that it demands me to draw better. It demands whoever's working with it to live in a more concrete, believable world. Drawing becomes more like sculptural drawing. In Tarzan, I personally wanted to be flying through the air. I'd seen my son skateboarding in Paris. I thought, what if Tarzan is a tree surfer instead? And so I did this as the first little test I did of Tarzan with deep canvas, where we were going to be animating in dimension. I showed this to the directors. This could be really cool and fun. And, it was such a freeing feeling to be Tarzan doing that. Thank you, Tarzan. Okay. There is this one point, and I have to kind of just share this with you. I got to this point here, and first, when he was about to grab that vine with his toes, first time I animated it, it just didn't look cool. It was sort of boring, and I didn't know why. And so then I went back and I studied gibbons. And I noticed that the gibbons, when they were grabbing vines with their hands and feet, they never looked at the vines. But I was having Tarzan look at the vine. And I realized, no, he's got to just be recklessly throwing himself out in space. So then I went back and I re-animated it. So he was just always looking beyond whatever he was grabbing onto. It gave it such a, just a whole different feeling of life to it. My dad did this cartoon, and the mother is saying, come in here and put on some proper clothes, Billy. Who do you think you are? This was the first time that Dad and I actually worked on a cartoon together. I did the Tarzan. But he knew what it was like to live in the skin of a character. So that stream, you know, that went underground, it came up in terms of a chance to draw and animate in charcoal. In Pocahontas, there's this little moment in Colors of the Wind where I got to animate. that charcoal, and it's my drawings are up on the screen there. It was a very satisfying completion of it.
Have you ever heard the wolf cry to the newborn moon?
To go frame by frame, and here's Rapunzel You know, she's going to desperately trying to get away. His mother Gothel is going to come after her. So throw her hip out, and I'm trying to think about going into a nice reverse. And as I'm doing that, I suddenly realized, I remembered Ollie saying, Glen, don't animate what the character is doing. Animate what the character is thinking. And I said that at that point as I was drawing over top of this. And what is she thinking? She wants to get away. So let's have her look the direction where she wants to go, off screen there. That's where she wants to go. And these moments were just kind of popping up for me throughout Tangled as I could kind of channel Frank and Ollie and Eric and things that I had heard from them. And passing on that baton is incredibly important from one to another. During Tangled, John Carr kept talking about this idea of Paper Man, and when we had a little bit of time, he asked me to work on a little test that I would work on with Patrick Osborne. He just did a beautiful film, Feast, which I hope you've seen or will see. It is stunning. So in this case, I was doing the thumbnails of Meg coming running out, chasing this little airplane, and I wanted to push her jumping and stretching, and so that it would be something that Patrick would then follow through with the animation of the CG version of it, and he would have to push the CG shapes to follow this. So this was our little test. It was kind of like a tag team wrestling where I did that, and then he went through and worked Meg, you know, in all of her design that we had done, pushing and forcing the exaggeration and the timing that was in the hand-drawn. It was this wonderful thing of standing on each other's shoulders. I really do believe that there is a wonderful collaboration between both hand-drawn and CG in the future. You can't really see this quote, but I can see it here. Let me back up just a second there. So when I was doing this animation, I was feeling, okay, Tangled was done, and what's next? And there was this bell went off in me that I needed to go out and find this something new. And at that time, I came across a quote, because I was struggling with, well, how can I do this? I can only trust it so much, you know, for me to pass on. I can't leave Disney, and what am I doing? I don't know what I'm going to do. Do I really want to leave? But something in me was saying, you've got to go. And I'd seen this quote. It said, this is from Goethe, and he said, until one is committed, there is hesitancy, the chance to draw back. Concerning all acts of initiative and creation, there is one elementary truth, that ignorance of which kills countless ideas and splendid plans, that the moment one definitely commits oneself, then providence moves too. All sorts of things occur to help one that would never otherwise have occurred. A whole stream of events issues from the decision, raising in one's favor all manner of unforeseen incidents and meetings and material assistance, which no man could have dreamed would have come his way. Whatever you can do, or dream you can do, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it. Begin it now. I talked to my wife, and she was like, I'm ready to go. Let's do it. So we took a step outside of Disney, and like I said, it was suddenly living without walls. There was all sorts of possibilities, but I wasn't sure what. And then one night, John Carrs and I, Doug Sweetland and Rodrigo Blas had dinner, just a guy's night out. We were talking about what each one was doing. And Doug kept talking about this animation with this virtual world thing that he was doing in connection with Google. And I said, well, what is it? He's, I don't know, you've got to just go see it. And next thing, Google calls, I went up and met Regina Dugan, and they had this little device, and it was this animation of, I was watching a Beyond Pink of Us from Windy Day. It was CG, and it was in a dimensional world, and I thought, well, it's such a little screen. Why do I want to animate on that tiny screen? I'm used to the big screens, and I realized, well, it's actually the largest screen possible. It's a virtual world out there, and I said, well, what do you want me to do with this? And she said, we just want you to make something beautiful and emotional. And, you know, all right, so what's the catch? Well, there is no catch. You just push yourself creatively, that's going to push us technologically. So, all right, let's do it. And so I went to Lake Arrowhead, where we have a house up in the mountains near LA, and asked Jenny Rim, who had worked at Pixar and Disney, working with animators, and then I had met her at Disney to come and produce. And my son Max, who has been an animator for, at that point, 15 years himself, and so he came on to as a production designer, and we started to develop this little story idea. There's my son Max, and that's him in the middle. And my grandson Henry. Now, little Henry is just like, you've got to use your family. I very much like my dad. I ripped my own family off wherever I could. And this is a little boy in Duet. He was an inspiration for that. As I was thumbnailing through it, it's hard to see up at the top there, but you could, it's kind of cut off, but there are cells, and I know that it's going to start, the animation is going to start with the cell, and you're going to follow the growth and evolution of a baby, and eventually there'll be a dog, and you'll watch it. But I thought, all right, well, so then I'll start exploring that, studying how a baby forms. And I started to study cellular growth and thinking about how I would animate that. And then I got to this point. Oh, so basically a baby turns into an alien. That's when I decided, okay, an aerobic poetic transition between the cell and the baby. And we started off on this journey of animating in an entirely new environment up at Google, where there is no animation, there are no rules. They don't know enough about animation to even create the rules yet. The first rule I heard was, not a rule, but a suggestion. The guy that was working on compression said, you know, Glenn, it would really help us here if you could animate at 60 frames per second. Well, that would be really nice for you guys, wouldn't it? I just spent 40 years thinking in 24 frames per second. How do I transpose it if you can't even divide 24 and 60? And for like a month, son Max and I and Jenny, we would come back from working there and just trying to figure out how do we make this work? Can it possibly work? Well, can I do animation that's actually going to feel right? Can we get it done in time? I'm just going to be throwing out everything and making mistakes all the time. I can't count on my natural sense of timing. And you're beginning to panic. But then I remember on the desk of Frank Thomas, Ollie Johnson, Eric Larson, all of those old guys, they had metronomes. I realized, you know, for those guys, 24 frames was just as weird for me as 60. And the way they solved it was just by that simple click of a metronome. You know, for them, it's 24, 24, 24, and I just need to think 60, 60, 60. 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30. And it's like, oh, well, sometimes in order to move forward, you have to just go back and stand on the truth, whatever that foundational thing is. And then you leap forward. And it became such a freeing thing. I mean, Max did this little thing of the Ten Commandments of 60 frames per second, where we figured it out, and he'd worship at that altar every day. And to animate in this environment where you give the audience the camera is quite a challenge. Here, this is Sarah Harris. She was my assistant. By the end, we were both wearing braces on our wrist after 10,000 drawings. But we were constantly looking at how the animation would play as you would follow one character to the next. You could turn. Jan Pinkabud is on the computer screen there. As Max is talking with him, we were constantly getting advice from him who had done the first animation on this. But it's a scary thing when you are controlling the composition, you're used to controlling it, and now you're putting the camera in the audience's hand. What I found was, instead of controlling, instead of forcing the audience into a composition, it was not controlling, it was coaxing. You were welcoming, you were seducing them to a certain place. And they got there by choice. And there's a certain investment that the audience has because they chose to go along on that journey with you. Rashid Elkarab is the guy in the black shirt in the middle. He was leading this team of tech guys, and they, in the room there, it was half programmers and the other half of us, we were animating. And Max was kind of the bridge between both groups, who understood both worlds. And on the walls, there was all kinds of code that was written, you know, that we'd throw out ideas. In the room, if you walk in, you'd hear half the room flipping paper, and the other half, it was kind of wonderful music that was going on. I do figure drawing classes for the programmers. It was a wonderful exchange of information, and what was funny is that often when you get somebody who's not done figure drawing, they draw really tiny in the corner, not comfortable. All of this, these programmers were drawing really big. They were just as bold in their figure drawing as they were in their creative code writing and inventing code. In exchange, they were teaching me algorithms. That's me pretending I know what I'm talking about. Basically algorithms, if this, then that. I mean, and they could break it down and help me understand that. At one point, we were showing the animation to Regina Dugan, who's the head of this research division at Google, the story, which is really following a little boy and a little girl, and you can choose which one, or you can go back and forth between them as they go around, and as they go around, they keep crossing paths, and when they cross, you could choose to follow one or the other. And she said, oh, it's kind of like a double helix with a time continuum in the middle. You can see the arrow going up to the T, and it's this double spiral staircase, and that as those staircases cross, you can hop from one to the other. And it was like, yeah, that's it. And it was wonderful because story to me has always been very linear, just visually linear. Go from beginning to middle to the end, and then the movie's done. And now I was thinking visually in another whole different way of a double helix. And because you think that way, you creatively think differently. Like the characters are actually living. There is no cut. For me, I think the longest scene I may have animated at Disney was, I don't know, maybe 25 seconds, maybe 30 seconds. I don't even know what that would have been. Maybe something in Rescuers when the eagle's flying off. But this was 5 minutes of unbroken animation, no cut ever, both characters moving in any path that they wanted to go, the backgrounds going off into space. It was this very liberating, freeing kind of way of thinking of animation. Storyboarding it, we would storyboard out two separate lines, and then they would come together wherever both characters were together as we just, you know, did a very rough little post-its. I got the best editor that I could. That's Henry helping me. He got into all of my story sketches, but I just couldn't tell him no. I didn't. Matter of fact, I haven't. As long as you feed this editor, he's pretty happy. So, in order to animate something, you have to understand. Like, in these a couple of sketches, I was going to do this pirouette. But in order to do a pirouette, you have to study dance. And I would go to ballet rehearsals, drawing the ballerinas. This was summer of 2013, or September, watching Swan Lake in Paris and sketching. And I realized, you know, to do a pirouette, you've got to learn how to do a pirouette. So I'm out there, and this is a friend, this is Benjamin Millepied, who's married to Natalie Portman and taught her to dance for Black Swan. And so he's just describing how to do this, and I'm giving him some pointers, you know, seeing how he's going to do it. But his movement is so smooth.
Oh my God.
So smooth. I got to show it again. Because to animate it, I was wondering about momentum. I mean, what is propelling you around? Is it? You get the feeling that he could have been spinning there forever and ever as he was explaining this to me. I knew that in the movement, you're going to be watching the characters grow, and I wanted little Mia to be skipping. So I asked my granddaughter, Matisse, to skip for me, and I started just studying this skip. Skip is an incredible thing. It's not a run. It's not a walk. And it's not a hop. It's all of them together, but motivated by joy. You never see adults skipping. And no kid is ever taught to skip. It just is like spontaneous combustion. It just pops out. And I just fell in love with the skip. Now, little Matisse, she thinks the whole film is all about her. So in animating in duet, where Mia, she's going to start to, you can start that again, where she grows up, you know, you go from this tiny little kid, and then as she starts to go into the skip, her back foot is her left foot there, and it moves forward and plants, now the right foot plants. Now, the next logical thing is the left foot should plant first, but no, the right foot does instead. Then the left one does. And it doesn't make any sense. That's because a kid invented it. It just happens. And what's wonderful is she grows up before her eyes and you almost don't even notice it. But hey, wait a second, she's wearing different clothes, her hair is different, and it's just like having a daughter that you watch grow up from a baby, and pretty soon they're getting married. And when did that happen? All the way through duet, the growth just happens, and before you know it, you're at the end. It's very much the way life is. One point in animating this, I realized the experience of animating these characters, they're real, they're living. Like here, I just wanted Tosh to get to this tree. So I animated a really rough little animation of him running along. He's growing up as he's getting closer, as he's going to run across some rocks by a stream and then across these rocks. And then he's going to go through this field. And as he gets into the field, I got to this point here, and I realized, wait a second, he doesn't want to go straight to the field. No kid ever goes in a straight line. He wants to move in. And then you can see there's a little ghost of a line there of that left leg as I had drawn it pushing out, and then I let him do what he wanted to do. This is early in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I'm animating. Jenny Rim is like, you've got to have this scene done. And I realized, yeah, but I can't control it. This is what he's going to do. And so I find that, oh, hey, there's a log in the field. And I didn't know that before, as he grabs it. And I realize that this is what he does every morning when he runs through the field. And he likes to grab onto this branch and then swing himself around and throw himself into the deep weeds. And I don't even have to animate it now. I'll just let the bird show it. It was sometimes when you're animating, you get to that moment where the character, you're just hanging on. And they're just living. When they get to the tree, we knew that we wanted dimension in it, and we were trying to figure out how do we show this dimension in the tree. It was all going to be drawn line, and the parallax. I mean, this is all a magic trick, because if you can see it on the device, as you turn around, you can go and explore all in the dimension of this tree. In order to do that, though, we had to really actually lay out like a mosaic for this tree, and I was trying to figure out how we're going to do this. I asked Sarah if she could put it together. I had 14 points of steps that we're going to have to follow, and she said, do you mind if I like eliminate half of them, half of those steps? I said, well, how? Well, we'll just take the artwork up onto the window before the sun goes down. We can trace it and create a mosaic of the whole thing, which is what we did. And then we spread that out on the ground, and I felt like I was a kid again, drawing in school. And it was this large, huge piece of animation paper as we planned out what the animation scale was going to be there. And Sarah, as you can see the brace in her hand there by this point, we both really just put so much of ourselves into the drawing. Everybody on the team, from Jenny to Max to our entire crew, worked tirelessly to get this done. In drawing, you discover things, a new way of drawing. As soon as that technology crosses your path, you find that you think differently, things in ways that you didn't think that you could think, like animating with light. Became really fascinating, less about the edges and more about the form that is described by light. Drawing her eyes, or they got into really close shot, you had to think in reverse in order to get to that. I draw like this to get that. But it's hard to think like that to get that. Because that looks weird and that looks beautiful. Found that with these Google glasses, there's Jenny with the Google glass, you could actually be looking at it in a negative, reversed way and draw. My daughter Claire did the color. Now both Claire and Max, they, being my children, they really value line. And Claire working color out, she did all the color work in Tangle, when Rapunzel paints on the walls, that's actually Claire's drawings. So we asked her to do the color. And so she did it in a way that would not take anything away from the drawing. It was very minimal color, but enough to give you a transition as you watch the characters change from one color to the next. The music was a huge challenge, because anytime you switch and move, follow one character to the other, you are actually like lifting the needle up from that LP and putting it on a different track over here that had to go together. And it was, as Scott says, it was like armadillo scales, that you would have one piece of music that would slide over the new piece in a way that you would never notice. It was really incredible. constantly what I refer to as dancing on the edge of cheesy. Really wanted this to be emotional and yet not go into the sappy sentimental, but I knew we were going to have to be dancing on the edge to get there. And musically, it was really important that he be along on that and was going to push those emotions musically. This was a very handcrafted picture, despite the fact that it was using the newest technology possible. We wanted handcrafted instruments. Like, in this case, it's a Stradivarius. This was a $6 million Stradivarius that we recorded with when Mia is dancing there. Pablo Picasso said, "I am always doing that which I cannot do in order that I may learn how to do it." And this is the thing for me. I feel like as soon as I get to the point where I know what I'm doing with this, I find that there's a need to keep growing and to move into a zone like Bobby was talking about, where fear, where there's a sense of fear. And the fear is, I don't know how to do this. And I know in here, we all have one thing in common. All of us are afraid that if everybody around you knew just how much you don't know what you're doing, you get booted out of it. That's how I feel. I've always just barely stayed ahead of the walls. I really don't know what the heck I'm doing. I'm just doing the thing that I love. And Picasso is saying, I'm always doing that, which I cannot do, in order that I may learn how to do it. The last thing I animated on the duet was this water reflection. Mia jumps into the pond, and I thought, well, we'll just do that with some kind of simulation. Procedurally, we'll make that the water reflection. But just for the fun of it, I wanted to look and watch that animation, or watch the actual water reflection on the bottom of the pool. And the more I studied it, I was just fascinated with the shape and the design, just pure moving graphic shape and design. It was mystery. It's like moving two directions at the same time, and shapes that as soon as you saw them, they morphed into something else, and I was fascinated by it. And I thought, I've seen this before. And when I saw Max's little boy Henry did this drawing, I was like, wait a second, those are all the same shapes that I saw. There's something absolutely beautiful. I mean, Max says that every line that is made is a unique creative moment in history, never to be repeated. And I thought, I want to know this. I want to know what that crazy kaleidoscope of lines is happening on there. So I animated just this pattern, just trying to understand it, trying to really understand the mystery. But there it was, and so then we went ahead and put that into the show. Reversed it from the top to the bottom, let her swim through that, and it just gave this wonderful sense of reality. You didn't see that in the theatrical version, because we just put it together for the interactive version. But when she jumps in, and it was so satisfying to see that happen, and she's swimming through it, there's this one moment, I remember animating that, I had this one fish that I just wanted, I don't know why, I wanted that fish to be swimming around her. And I thought, well, this is really fun, and then I realized, oh, wait a second, she's got to go out of the water, and now the fish is going to die. Well, I'll just turn it into a bird. this little presentation about duet. I would love to be able to show you duet, but the device broke a little earlier, and we can't do that. But it is coming out, and everybody in the world will be able to see this on Androids and those possibly even beyond coming up soon. But while we got a few moments, though, maybe we can have a few questions. Do we have any time for that?
All the time you want.
We do have some time? Okay. What's that? No, I don't want to leave ever. I just want to. Yes, of course I've been there. Like I said, I honestly look at you as way beyond where I was when I was starting. But what happened for me was I was working and things were going along well and I was learning. And then inevitably, and I know anybody that's been doing this for very long at all, hits a stage where they hate what they're doing. And it stinks. It's just bad. He's like, this is, Bobby was talking about that. And you feel like you pretty much, well, I guess this is, my shelf life is kind of run out, and it's run out at 20 years old, or whatever it is, and yikes, how am I going to get better? And I found myself